It's Titanic 2. No, it's about, although there's a lot of water, it's about a kid who's depressed and not having the best of times, trying to kind of figure out who he is in life in Wales. And then this American guy turns up and gives him a tutorial in being cool with some consequences.
Can you tell us about the process of writing the film, where your inspirations came from initially?
Strangely, an Eminem song, which was, there was a lyric called, there was a lyric that was, best believe somebody's paying the Pied Piper. I kind of got obsessed with the Pied Piper story and came up with Emile Hirsch's character being a kind of Pied Piper-esque, coming into town and helping this kid out and then, with no reward, going crazy. It kind of is loosely based on my childhood, just events that happened in which I thought I was very pathetic in handling. So I kind of put that in there, and my character is kind of a reflection on what life was growing up in the valleys in Wales, a very quiet, kind of nihilistic, almost Roy Anderson-esque place. Location is great in Wales just because it's so beautiful, so it really helped for my story in the fact that, you know, this kid was having such a depressing time even though he's placed in this beautiful area. I like location. I think movies in studios are just as good. I mean, like, I like studio movies. I have no preference. It was always the intention to direct, so I wrote the script, you know, with the intention to direct, not to act in it. By no means do I think I can do all three. I just wanted to save money, really, because we had such little money. It just seemed easier for me to act in it and then, you know, like, rehearse at home on my own, like a schizophrenic, and that would save time, essentially. I love Paul Thomas Anderson. I feel his work is so well thought out, and just, you know, you could tell his love for film. Jim Jarmusch, I love Jim Jarmusch's movies. They're awesome. Bertolucci, very good. I mean, yeah, kind of David Lynch. Loads of weird people.
And are there any particular directors you've worked with that have given you good advice, or you feel like you learned something specific from?
I know Richard Ayoade from Submarine, and would ask him stuff, and it'd be stupid. You know, it's like having a friend that's a genius and then not asking them for advice. So, yeah, definitely Richard and David Gordon Green, probably. David Gordon Green helped me get Emile Hirsch, so, yeah, I have a lot to thank him for.
Do you have a fondest memory from, say, a day that was the most special to you on this one?
The first day was the good day, just because, I don't know, I was just so excited that people had come together to make something an idea that I came up with, and that I just felt very grateful at the whole experience. I do a lot of broing out with Emile in it. That was pretty fun. He's such a funny actor that it was just incredible to do that. This is a kind of scene where we're doing press-ups, like the kind of Rocky montage, I suppose. And I don't know, he just took it so seriously that I couldn't help but laugh. It was just so good. He's very funny. Emile's character, Dean, is kind of symbolic for everything that a teenager sees as cool, and kind of like the devil in a way. And Emile Hirsch is just a phenomenal actor. He's so good in the movie. I'm so happy he would participate in the craziness. And I just couldn't believe we actually got him on a movie that's so low budget. For me, it's mind-blowing that people will actually see a movie in which I've made. So I think it's great. I do think there's definitely there's a magic to having a movie in a cinema, especially now that so much TV has gone online. The lines between TV and film slightly become blurred. But it's a fantastic platform for, you know, people's art or anything to be kind of out there and for people to see it. It's incredible.
What are you hoping an audience takes away from the film overall?
I hope they're confused. I hope that they enjoy it, and if they don't understand it, watch it again, I suppose.
And do you have other projects in mind, both from a writing point of view and directing?
I've just written another script in which I plan to direct, and we're just attaching cast for that, and yeah.
Can you tell us anything about that, just sort of generally what kind of film it is?
It's based on a true story of a paranoid schizophrenic. So tells the story of a lady called June navigating her way through a nightmare.
So you've got a lot of other great stuff coming up as well. Red Oaks, can you tell us a little bit about that again, just for people who aren't familiar with it?
Absolutely. Red Oaks is this 80s TV show, set in the 80s in a country club. I play a guy called David Myers, who's coming of age over a summer, I suppose. He's a tennis pro and trying to figure out what he wants to do with his life and whether or not, you know, his girlfriend is who he wants to spend his life with. And yeah, it's very cool. It's like The Graduate kind of thing. And it's produced by Steven Soderbergh, and it's got David Gordon Green directing, and Amy Heckling and Hal Hartley are directing some episodes.
Obviously, I mean, Submarine was another great coming-of-age story. Why do you think that particular transition, that period in our lives, is so eternally fascinating for us?
I think it's because we don't want to actually revisit it, but it's nice to see it reflected back to us, because nobody really enjoyed it. Even the people that probably enjoyed it probably regret a lot of things that they did growing up. I mean, I don't know, it's such a weird stage in which nobody knows anything. And then as life goes on, you know even less.
And is that a fair description as well also of the 1980s, do you think?
Yeah, I mean, 1980s are just filled full of happiness, denim, and songs that are very slow.
Any particularly interesting outfits you've got a chance to wear on Red Oak?
Yes, I wear very short shorts, which I apologize in advance.
What are you hoping an audience takes away from the film overall?
I hope they're confused. I hope that they enjoy it, and if they don't understand it, watch it again, I suppose.
Fantastic to have you here tonight at the Picture House. Are you looking forward to the screening?
Yeah, I can't wait. I think it's going to be really good. I'm genuinely intrigued.
Are you a fan of Craig and the stuff he does?
Yeah, I mean, I'm intrigued to see what his movie's going to look like. I've met him a few times before, and he's a really nice lad and talented as an actor, and it'd be interesting to see what he's like as director as well.
And is directing something you'd ever be interested in?
Yeah, I would. I'd love to have a go. I haven't quite pulled it off yet. I haven't quite had the balls to commit fully like he has, but I'd like to at some point.
We're loving Scorch Trials at the moment, of course. What are you most proud of now that that's out there and people are enjoying it?
The fact that it's out there and people are enjoying it. I mean, that's something I'm hugely proud of. And the fact that we get to go back and make a third one, and hopefully they'll go out and see that one too. I quite like the way, they're called Wicked, they seem pretty bad, but I don't really think of them as an out-and-out baddie, which I found quite interesting. They're out to cure the world of this disease, and we're just trying to survive, so I mean, there is no real definite goodie or baddie.
What are you most excited about getting to finish off that journey?
I'm excited, to do exactly that, to finish off the journey that we started a while ago, and I get to go back and work with all my friends again and just kind of conclude the piece that we started.
We spoke to you guys at the premiere, and it seems like there's an amazing family. Why is that? Why have you guys all seemingly got this amazing chemistry together, do you think?
To be honest, I'm not entirely sure. I think a bit of it is luck. I don't quite know. We're all quite different people, but we genuinely get on very, very well. I think we respect one another hugely as actors and also as people, and I think that our relationship's really come across quite well on screen, and it makes it a much more enjoyable experience anyway.
Is there anything else you're working on at the moment?
No, nothing at the moment. I'm doing Thunderbird's voiceover at the moment, so that's kind of an ongoing thing, which is fun. No, just auditioning, you know.
I mean, obviously people recognise your voice from many things, but I mean, Phineas and Ferb is something that people have grown up loving. Can you talk a little bit about being involved in that and voice acting, I guess, specifically?
That's great. I mean, that's my first time ever doing voice acting. I think I started when I was 17, 18, something like that. Swampy, the creator of the show, he wanted a kind of young, typically British sounding voice, Love Actually, and gave me a shot at the pilot, and I went in and did my first thing in front of a microphone, and it was a fun experience, and it's been going on for years now. It's slowly winding down, and I haven't done a voiceover record with them for a while. We might do the odd special here and there, but it's been a great journey, and again, working with some great people, and it's got me into the world of voiceover, which is really fun. It's something quite different from film acting, but it was a new challenge that I was quite happy to have a go at. Come see this movie. It looks great. Support young, talented British people wanting to act and direct and get out there and do it yourself as well.